Now for your morning news summary. The war situation. Berlin. Flyers picture Soviet retreat as a melee. London. Reporter has an experience with the spy fever. Berlin. Germans assert capture of Kyiv is imminent. Berlin. British Soviet accord called a suicide pact. Moscow. Reds report Germans suffer heavy losses. Vichy. Beitan admits Syrian defeat, armistice signed. Shanghai, port of Kobe closed, hint southward move. Washington, president demands action to lengthen service of draftees. Sumner Wells, U.S. not bound to respect Portuguese island rule. Congressman calls Colonel Wedgwood ungrateful to U.S. Britain denies using Lend-Lease aid to promote her own trade. Senator Lucas won't be bound by secret committee sessions. Local Chicago, final tally of war poll votes show 80% voting no. Posse of 200 hunts St. Charles parolee killed woman. British offer to sell rubber to American firm. Eggs to be imported from Argentina by American dealer. Grand jury hears Caldwell, ex-convict, accused by union. 8 jurors chosen in policeman's slaying trial. Domestic. Fight on Reds in union costs sailor is U.S. job. Light planes to be tested in desert war games. Governor Talmadge ousts 2 Georgia educators on racial issue. Several paralysis cases reported near Camp Forest, Tennessee. Influx of alien doctors alarms American medical men. Sports. Sox stop Yanks 7-1 fluke hit saves DiMaggio. Southern coaches honor linemen in college all-star vote. Red Grange files $50,000 libel suit against Wendell Wilson. Whirl away to show Chicagoans his speed today. Bob Feller adds number 18 to his string, beats Red Sox 4-1. Commerce and finance. OPM picks firms to run 7 vast new aluminum plants. More millions earmarked for armaments as orders are let. Railroad shares give a lift to lagging stock market. Unauthorized strike ties up Eastern Steel Plant. Grain market droops, wheat closes a cent lower. Good evening and welcome to July 15th and July 16th, 1941. My name is Henry Chop, your host. We are covering 2 dates today, and we are going to listen to 2 episodes of The Goldbergs, Vic and Sade, Frank Buck's Jungle Quiz, The Adventures of Superman, and a big band remote, Jimmy Dorsey and the Orchestra. I will tell you a little bit more about these programs in just a little bit. If you enjoy the content of this channel, not only subscribe, but please donate to its upkeep. Because of the vintage radio, music, and films that we share, this channel does not qualify for YouTube monetization. Help motivate us to consistently post this wonderful content. We like to think that this channel is more interesting and entertaining than any other World War II channel on YouTube. Help us keep going by donating. In the expanded description section to this video, you will find 2 links for which to donate. One is for PayPal and the other is for a GoFundMe. If the GoFundMe link is outdated on this video, go to this channel's description or our latest video where you will find an updated link. Any little bit helps. If you love old-time radio, film, and music, don't forget to subscribe to this channel and click on the bell icon to get notifications as to when a new upload will premiere. If you are interested in World War II as much as I am, check out our other channel, the World War II newspaper channel. Expand the description section to this video and you will see a link that will take you there. Now I'd suggest listening to the latest upload to decide if it's your thing. Over there you will hear the Chicago Tribune read to you for between 90 minutes to 2 hours. You will get a much more detailed look about what it was like to actually live through World War II than I can give you just by sharing radio broadcasts.
You will not only hear detailed news of the big battles and historical events, you will hear trivial facts about the war. You will hear news from the United States home front from the early stages of U.S. mobilization and war protests to Pearl Harbor and the ramping up of the war machine to the final victories and reconversion. You will hear every facet of American life change forever.
My name is Henry Chop, your host, and those of you who listened yesterday remember me saying that we were going to have a Mr. and Mrs. North program tonight. Well, that program was misdated from the original source when I looked it up in a reliable episodic log. It was actually dated July 1st, 1947. Actually, what rang the bell for me was that it had a totally different sound than radio programs from this era. If you notice, when we go back to the 1938 programs and compare to 1941, they had a really different style to them. The same with post-war radio as opposed to pre-war radio, the 1940-41 type era. So that just kind of rang a bell for me, and I'm like, I said to myself, I better look this thing up because the date does not sound accurate, and sure enough, it wasn't. I apologize for any inconvenience for that. And also, I want to mention one other thing real quick. Thank you, Larry, for your contribution to the channel. I really appreciate it. I know I've been lax at saying that. You've donated about a week ago, and I just am now getting around to saying it. If I don't write it down, I forget about it. So I am really sorry for that. We are still in the dog days of summer back in 1941, and as a result, there is just limited radio, just not a lot of stuff until we get to the fall season, the 1941-42 radio season, when things really start to get interesting. But anyway, tonight we are going to start out with the Goldbergs from July 15th, and this aired at 2:30 in the afternoon over CBS. And then at 2:45 in the afternoon, we are going to tune the dial over to NBC Red for Vic and Sade. Now, this episode does not have a specific date. It's just dated July 1941. But since we have a lack of programming today, I thought it would fit well into tonight's lineup. And then following that, we actually have a date on this one, July 15th, 1941. We have Frank Buck's Jungle Quiz, a quiz show. And I could not find an exact time of airing for this. I don't know if it aired only on the West Coast, if Chicago just simply didn't carry it, or whatnot. But it did air over Mutual. You will hear the Mutual Broadcasting System tagline at the end of the program. For all I know, this could have even been an audition program for a fall series. I just don't know. And then following that, I will do another 3-minute news summary. Then we will get into July 16th with the Goldbergs. And, of course, 2:30 in the afternoon, Chicago time over CBS. Then we have The Adventures of Superman, a syndicated show. I did not see it in the Chicago radio listings. And no Lone Ranger today. There is no Lone Ranger episode for this date. Somebody must have stole it and hidden it away. But there is no Lone Ranger episode today. But we are going to close it out with a big band remote, Jimmy Dorsey and the Orchestra from the Cafe Rouge in the Hotel Pennsylvania in New York City. You gotta love the way the big band announcers set the stage for these remotes. It's just it's wonderful. It really evokes the time. It evokes class. And what is special about this big band remote is Jimmy Dorsey and the orchestra were pretty much at their peak at this time. I mean, if you follow the Hit Parade jukebox every Saturday, you can see it. I mean, he has almost every song on the Hit Parade jukebox. On this remote, you will hear two of those songs and then three or four other musical numbers by him. But you'll hear two of the songs from the Hit Parade jukebox. And this Jimmy Dorsey band remote does not have an exact date. It's just dated 1941. So I don't even know if it was in July, but the music certainly fits this time period, judging from what is played on the Hit Parade jukebox. So that's how we're going to close it out tonight, with a big band remote. So kind of sparse as far as the old-time radio goes, but some good stuff. I'll see you on the other side. Let's turn on this old tube radio. That's our time machine, and give this stuff a listen.
And now, the Goldbergs. In everyday life, it's sometimes the understanding and the sympathy we find among those we live with that we never notice. But these same traits, made precise, scientific, and complete, are the basis for the technique Dr. Cater's been using on Sammy and Sylvia. It was this more than anything else that gave Molly Goldberg the confidence which supported her during Sammy's illness and Sylvia's presence at Lastonbury. And now, Sylvia says she's fallen in love with Dr. Cater. Just where it will lead her and just what effect it will have on Sammy, we don't know yet. But late tonight, on the day of the strange picnic which Dr. Cater created for his two young patients, Molly sitting home with Rosie.
The time is right, Rosalie.
Certainly should be back by now.
Not so loud, Rosalie. Please, not so loud. I don't want Papa to start in again. Please. Jake, dear. Where's Papa? Peek-a-boo inside, darling.
He was reading his paper.
Go see, Mama, please. No?
He's in there.
Isn't there? So why didn't he answer me? Jake, dear. Dearest. Want to play solitaire?
That again.
Put some fruit to the table. No, a little cold lemonade. I made it special in case somebody should fall in.
Jay, dear, are you snoozing?
I'm not snoozing.
So come in here if you're not snoozing. Come in, dear. Stay here.
Look at the time, look. A boy just out of a sick bed.
Not so late, dear. With the daylight saving in the east and western time, it stays light. And before it's dark, it's late, and it's not late, Jake. Sit, dear.
Where did Allison vent?
He went to write some letters and then expire. He's tired. The climate of the northern atmosphere makes him sleepy, he said.
I wish he'd wake up and take his daughter home already. That's what I wish.
No, Rosalie, you're bringing the lemonade?
I'm going
to Papa don't like it sweet.
Papa can't take anything sweet anymore, Rosalie. It's been so sour for me for so long. You hear?
Why, Jake, please.
Now, don't start. Because if you do, I'll spoil your evening and mine. Better be quiet.
Here, Papa, darling.
Why didn't you bring him? Papa would spill himself.
It's all right. He can spill me. Put it down.
You want the cards, Mark? Solitaire, Jake.
Why not? When it comes to solitaire, I should be an expert. I'm always alone. Alone in everything. My wishes, my desires, my ideas, my plans, my entire whole life. Always alone. Nobody to share with me.
You mind if I go to bed, Nora? No. Good night. No. You're wrong, Pa. You were the one and nobody else that liked Sylvia when this whole thing started. Mama worried, and now when she's willing to take the advice of somebody that she knows more than she does, you're angry. Dr. Cater knows what he's doing. If he asked Sylvia and Sammy out for the day, he's had his reasons. He knows what he's doing.
All right, Rosalie, please.
You have to admit, Pa, that there are some things you don't know.
There are many things I don't know, but they don't include my family. My family, I know. Would that they know me as I know them. Because I like Sylvia once. The blame remains mine forevermore, eh? Very well. I'll take it as I always take it. Good night.
Because I like it, though, I have to come. They blame me all the time. All right, I'll take it. I can take it.
Take back the lemonade. Ma, I'm
all right, Rosalie. You said it. You said it.
Here, put it in the kitchen and bring me a flashlight.
What, Ma?
I'll close the barn door. If not, it'll flap all night. Where did you put the little box from the car?
It's
there someplace. All right, I have it. Did you water mine petunias?
I did, Ma.
Come, you got the flashlight, Rosalie?
Uh-huh. I'll go with you.
Go with me? All right, so come. Look out, kitty. Look out, kitty. Don't you want to put something on your shoulder?
No, it's all right, Ma.
Come, open the door. Okay. Look at all the stars.
Uh-huh.
Beautiful. Like the Milky Way, the stars are. Come this way, better. Mm. Come.
Mm.
Put on the flashlight. Don't trip,
Ma.
I wouldn't. Be careful.
Oh, I think the battery's burned out. The
battery's burned out? Oh, it's a light night, you see. Come. This way, darling. All
right. Ma.
Yeah?
Wait. Don't you hear voices?
So, Sammy and Sylvie. Walk this way. They shouldn't see us. I'd want them to see us. Walk this way, darling.
Stay with me.
What you're doing is shutting your eyes and holding out your hand like a child. You're saying, leave me.
Yes, that's what I'm saying, Sammy.
It's wrong.
Why is it wrong? All my life I did things for myself, and look what happened. Maybe there are people like me who can't live any other way. We have to be told. We have to obey.
There's no one in the world like that. Not even the smallest child.
I'm like that. Are you angry with me?
No.
Do you despise me?
No.
I do love him, Sammy.
That's what you said.
That's what I feel. You must think I'm crazy. Feeling one day I love you and the next that it's someone else.
No.
Is it true what you said the other night, Sammy?
About what?
You said it was part of Dr. Cage's treatment to...
Well, if you're in love with him, it doesn't matter how it happened.
But you did say it.
I meant that patients sometimes do fall in love with their doctors. They don't realize that the trust they feel, the confidence the doctor inspires in them, is part of the treatment. Patient sometimes pushes it too far.
Well, that isn't the way it is with me, Sam. I love
you. Why do you keep saying that to me?
Oh, I'm sorry. I've harmed you. Hurt you in so many ways. You'll be glad to get rid of me.
Don't go around blaming yourself. You don't have to be afraid of the whole world. Change completely, Sylvie. Don't give up.
I'm not. But, Sammy, I've got to talk to you. I can't talk to anyone else.
Talk to Dr. Cater. I mean, you can talk to him.
I've got to explain to you. I can't just say I've changed and let it go at that. I've no right to.
You don't have to explain anything to me.
It's not right. Oh, Sammy, please. Listen to me.
Yes, Sylvia.
Forgetting everything else. The way I lied, the way I cheated. Forgetting that if you can. I mean, even if I was the girl you first thought I was, we weren't the ones for each other.
Why go through all those things again, Sylvia?
Because we have to be honest. We have to be truthful. That's what Dr. Cater says. We've got to be truthful with each other and act like human beings. We weren't for each other, Sammy. The girl you wanted, someone like yourself, with ideas like yours, interested in ideas and books and writing, someone with enthusiasm and truth like you, always wanting to understand and make people different and better, always trying, always hoping, a girl, and even I can say it, like your mother must have been when she was young. Not a girl like me. And I needed someone like Dr. Cater, older than I am and wiser. Someone who could take care of me and tell me what to do. Someone who won't need me the way I need him.
You know who you're describing, Sylvia?
Dr. Cater.
No.
I am?
No. There's only one person in the world who doesn't need you and whom you need. Only one kind of person who'll care for you and help you and expect nothing back. What you want, Sylvia, what you're asking for, what you need, perhaps, is not some man you can love. Someone who's here. Here now.
I don't understand.
You never tried to. I think, deep down, Sylvia, what you need is not a husband or a lover or a friend.
What else is there?
A father. That's what you need, Sylvia. A father.
Has Sammy suddenly glimpsed the goal toward which Dr. Cater's working? Dr. Cater seems well on his way to saving two lives from the trap they made for each other.
Stay tuned next for Vic and Sade.
And now get ready to smile again with radio's home folks, Vic and Sade.
Oh, Mom, any of that swell cake left from last night? You know, that one with the raspberry jam stuck in between.
Why, yes, there's a little left, Tommy.
Well, can I have some before I go out and play? Can I, Mom?
Why, yes, dear. But you didn't used to be so crazy about my cakes.
Well, gee, you didn't used to make them so good.
Oh, I guess you're right, Tommy. My cakes were so good before I started using new Sure Mix Crisco.
Yes, that's how it is. Even the youngsters notice the difference when you change to the new Sure Mix Crisco for your cakes. Because with this amazing new Crisco, you can now make cakes that are lighter, smoother textured, and better eating than you ever made them before, even with the most expensive cake shortening. And we don't know of a single other shortening besides Crisco that now gives you those three exclusive new cake-making advantages. Yes, lighter, smoother textured, better eating cakes. Now, that's because Sure Mix Crisco is the result of a revolutionary shortening discovery, a discovery you get only in the new Crisco. So naturally, no other home shortening can promise you such wonderful results in cakes. Why, just wait till the first time you use the new Crisco. Then you'll know it's different from other shortenings. In fact, you'll be delighted with a different kind of batter you get. It's so satiny smooth. Yes, smoother than you ever dreamed possible. You know, we tested those smoother Crisco batters right in our Crisco kitchens. Yes, we baked hundreds of cakes using many different recipes and every well-known shortening we could buy. And what happened? Well, just listen. The cakes made with Sure Mix Crisco were consistently lighter and smoother in texture than those made with any other shortening. They were the best eating cakes of all. Yes, we proved that you can make lighter cakes with the new Sure Mix Crisco. But the best proof for you is to try Crisco for cakes right in your own kitchen and serve your family better eating cakes made with Crisco.
No, we haven't even started to leave yet, Fred. I don't guess Vic's even got a shirt on yet. Oh, I expect you ought to be there in the next 20, 25, 30 minutes. Uh-huh. Oh, really, Fred? How you mean? Oh? Oh, uh-huh. Well, I'll tell him.
Where's my blue necktie?
Uh-huh. I see. All right, I'll tell him.
Say, she's talking on the telephone. Where's my blue necktie?
Just a second, Fred. What's the commotion?
Gus hollering for his blue necktie.
It's in your left-hand dresser drawer.
Well, what's it doing there? I keep my neckties on the rack in my clothes closet.
I pressed it this morning.
I bet that remark took the teeth out of Gus' fury.
Yeah, I bet it did. Sorry, Fred. Had to holler to Vic upstairs. Yeah. All right. Goodbye, Fred. You're specially invited to come with us.
Am I?
Mr. Sandbottom said to bring you if you weren't busy otherwise.
Probably just politeness.
No, he made a particular point of it. Wouldn't be surprised but what they laid in extra ice cream and salted peanuts.
I'm no good at you people's card parties. I'm not allowed in the 500 game. I'm not even encouraged to take part in the conversation. Only thing I can do is fish a book out of the bookcase and lay down on the davenport and read.
Well, suit yourself about it.
We'd better go over to Vernon Pickle's house.
Suit yourself.
My abject apologies, Dr. Speech.
Did you find your blue necktie?
Yes, and I feel like a cat in a feather. Here I was screaming and bellyaching about my blue necktie, and all the while my dear little wife had ironed it and laid it away neatly in my dresser drawer. It's all I can do to hold back the bitter tears of remorse. I'm a brute and you're an angel.
Sure.
Who's on the telephone?
Fred. Oh, by the way, Willie, before I forget, trot out in the cellarway and get Gov's overalls.
Overalls?
Fred said to bring them along.
What for?
I imagine it's mostly nonsense.
Why?
He was laughing so hard he could hardly speak.
Reconstruct the conversation.
Well, let's see. He said...
Rick and I are going to change the tires on my automobile?
No.
Well, that's what he said the last time he asked me to bring my overalls over.
No, it wasn't anything about his automobile. I think it's just some comical horseplay. He was laughing his head off.
You asked him why he wanted me to bring my overalls over, I suppose?
Yeah.
What was his rejoinder?
Before we start the 500 game, your old man and myself are going to sneak off down cellar a few minutes and knock out the partition between the coal room and the fruit room.
Fresh.
Yeah?
Instead of trapping to the cellarway and fetching my overalls, you will oblige Papa by stepping upstairs and fetching my easy slippers.
What's the idea?
I'm staying home is the idea.
How do you mean?
I mean what I say. Sneak off down cellar a few minutes and knock a partition, yeah?
He was laughing, Dad.
Yeah, I bet he was. That big slob.
You think he intends
to... Of course. I can just hear him. Your old man and myself are going to sneak off down cellar a few minutes and knock out the partition between the coal room and the fruit room. A few minutes, huh? That partition is concrete.
Hmm?
A big baboon invites a guy to his home to play cards and tries to squeeze 5 or 6 hours of hard labor out of him.
Mom, that explains why I was invited.
Huh?
You said Mr. Stenbottom particularly urged me to come along.
Yeah.
He can use another strong back and weak mind.
Fathead.
Oh, Vic, we can't just not go.
I beg to differ.
He laughs so hard.
Well, he's laughing so hard, it is my sincere wish that he chokes.
But from the way he talked, it was my kind of halfway impression. He meant you two fellas were going to skip down in the basement and be gone a few little measly minutes and skip back up again.
Well, you've been in Stembottom's half-wit basement, say. You're familiar with the partition between the coal room and the fruit room. It's concrete, ain't it? Could any two guys in the world knock out a concrete partition in a few little measly minutes? Why, it'd mean at least 5 hours back-breaking labor.
Well, Fred certainly took me in. I expect you're right and all, but at the same time...
Well, of course I'm right. By George, that big yap's got more crust than a horse.
I know, Ruth. He's got nothing to do with it.
Skip down cellar a minute and knock out a concrete partition.
They got in ice cream and salted peanuts.
Ice cream and salted peanuts are a rich prize to dangle in front of a guy's eyes. But there's not enough ice cream and salted peanuts in the country to buy 5 hours of hard labor off in me.
Well, what did I better do? Telephone?
Yeah. Call up Stenbottom and tell him to hurry over here with a shovel, because we're going to have a high old time digging a 50-foot well. And as soon as we get through, everybody gets a cold boiled potato.
I have to give some excuse to Ruthie.
I'm sick.
What?
Tell her Rush suddenly fell ill. The poor little chap out of a clear sky started to babble. And you took my temperature, and it was 111, by George. And the doctor's here now, and Vic's sitting in the corner with his face in his hands, and several trained nurses are coming by fast automobile.
Oh, yes. Look, I'll leave our call up and talk to Ruthie herself. I'll ask her right straight out without any shilly-shally if Fred actually means he wants
telephone
to...
Telephone, Dan.
That's good old Fred. Oh, by the way, Sadie, tell Vic to bring a pickaxe. We're going to have more fun in the circus tonight. We're going to rip the shingles off in the roof.
Hello? Oh, yes, Uncle Fletcher. Fine, thank you. He's well. Yes, and Rush, too. Uh-huh, he's a good boy. Why, just a second, Uncle Fletcher. Wants to come over this evening.
Good, great, elegant. There's an out. If we got guests, naturally we can't leave.
But we already accepted the 500 invitation. They'll smell a mouse.
Let him smell a mouse. Let him smell an elephant. I'll talk to Fred. I'll fix it up.
All right. Uncle Fletcher? Yeah, come ahead. Be delighted to have you. No, not at all. No, not at all, Uncle Fletcher. Fine. You bet. Elegant. We'll be looking for you. Goodbye.
Now, if you'll slap over the telephone, I'll make contact with Brother Stenbottom, that big ox.
I hate stuff like this.
So do I.
We should use my scheme. Rush has fell ill. Poor little tyke's all broken out in green splotches. His tongue lolls out of his mouth. His eyes are glassy, his throbbing pulse...
I appreciate silence for a moment, Diego. 2572X, please. Yes?
I hope it's Fred answers. Otherwise, it'll be embarrassing.
Mm.
Poor Ruthie got in ice cream and salted peanuts and everything. I just hate stuff for a person...
Is this the governor of Wyoming? Hello, Fred. Fine, thanks. Say, Fred, here's the situation... there's a wrench in the machinery. Well, it seems Sade's uncle's looking in on us after a bit. Yeah, you know, Uncle Fetcher. Yeah. Yeah, that's right. Uh-huh. So here was my idea. Instead of us coming over to you guys' house, how about you guys coming over here?
I hate stuff like this. Just hate it.
Oh, really, Fred? Is that a fact? I see. Well, in that case... Yeah. Well, in that case, Fred, it looks like we can't get together at all. No. No, I'm sorry, too. You bet. Oh, well, plenty other evenings. You bet. You bet, Fred. Okay. Okay. Bye, Fred.
Not coming, huh?
No. That big hyena.
Well, what'd he say?
Just like I figured. He's going to tear out his half-wit concrete petition. He planned to shove a bush of a back-breaking labor off on a poor lug he invited to his home to play cards.
Well, what'd he say? Couldn't he leave his petition go till some other night?
No.
Why?
Because he's got a couple of guys from the foundry dropping in after a while.
Oh, to help him knock out the petition?
Yeah.
Huh.
Satisfied now? Fred is a baboon, ain't he? Is Fred a baboon?
Yeah.
Let us all take pen and ink and write on the inside of our hat, Fred Stembottom is a baboon. A big baboon.
Poor Ruthie. Got in all that ice cream and salted peanuts.
Those big bruisers from the foundry can devour him. Side little chicken liver.
Yeah?
Come upstairs and fetch me down my easy slippers.
Which concludes another brief interlude at the small house halfway up in the next block. And here we leave Vic and Sade until the next time.
Lady, if you want your men folks to come right out in the open with praise for your cakes, then be sure you make them with Sure Mix Crisco. Because that amazing new Crisco can promise you cakes that are lighter, cakes that are smoother in texture, and cakes that are better eating than any other home shortening we know of. You see, Crisco is now made by an exclusive process that offers you those three important new cake-making advantages. Yes, lighter, smoother texture, better eating cakes than you've ever made before. Just the kind of cakes a fellow likes best. Believe me, you'll even like the wonderful new kind of cake batter you get with Sure Mix Crisco. Yes, you will, because Crisco batters are smooth as satin. They don't separate or curdle the way batters made with other shortenings so often do. And once you've enjoyed the lighter, smoother textured cakes you can make with those satiny batters, you'll agree they're absolutely the best eating cakes you ever made. So make a note right now to order Crisco for your cakes. And don't forget to listen to Vic and Sade tomorrow. This is Ed Hurley, he's speaking.
Stay tuned next for Frank Buck's Jungle Quiz.
Good hunting, everybody. This is the first of the Frank Buck Jungle Quizzes. Wild and woolly, dignified and academic, take your choice, but here we are. Frank Buck, the greatest of all the wild animal collectors. The man who can accept an order for a gray squirrel or a white rhinoceros without batting an eye. You've seen his amazing motion pictures. You who live near towns that have zoos probably know some of his old friends. But anyhow, my old friend, the mayor old friend, and your new friend, Frank Buck, the man who brings them back alive.
Hello, everybody. Thank you. Thank you, friends. And I do have friends in every zoo in the United States. Every zoo in the world, for that matter. And I hope that all those animals that are living in the zoological gardens so happily are my friends. I know I took them from their old land and country where they'd lived. But there they had to fight for their three square meals a day. Now they have people like me to bring the meals to them. And I wonder who really won.
Well, you make it sound rather difficult, but that's not why we're here at the moment. I have something like 20 young would-be wild animal tamers, or tamers from St. John's Orphanage in Brooklyn, in the careful care of Brother Thomas Law, who would like to ask you a few questions, Frank. Can you stand the shock?
Oh, I have. Try me this time.
Well, they They seem to think that they know a few things about animals that, have escaped you. Anyway, they think they have a few questions that you may not be able to answer.
Well, I hope they have. I really mean that. For it's always good to learn that one doesn't know everything about something as big as God's out of doors. Still, they've got to be good.
They'd better be not too good. Frank, the first inquisitor, and by the law has just picked the slip bearing his questions and his name out of the hat, is Richard Hand. Dickie, come on up and take your chair right here in front of Frank Buck, will you? You take your question. Richard Hand has two questions, and Brother Thomas Law and myself decided, beyond equivocation, by virtue of having picked the slip out of the hat, that you ought to know the answers, Mr. Buck. If you don't know on your own, all right, take it away.
All right, Richard.
What snake is the deadliest?
What snake is the deadliest? Well, there are a lot of very deadly snakes. I think the king cobra is really the deadliest because he's the biggest of all the poisonous snakes. His poison isn't really any more venomous than the fleur-de-lance or the very big diamondback rattler, but he has so much more venom in his poison sacs that he's really more deadly than any of the others.
And what does the orang-utang look like?
What does he look like? Well, he's a big, sort of a man-like ape with long red hair, red fur. A big full-grown orangutan has an arm spread of, 8 or 9 feet from fingertip to fingertip. And a weigh over 200 pounds. Tremendous animal and very ferocious when they're full grown. They come from Borneo and Sumatra.
What makes them so hard to catch?
Well, because they're big and tough. The young ones are not hard to catch. As a matter of fact, they're very easy. But a big full grown orangutan is a tremendous job to handle.
By the way, Mr. Buck, how do you pronounce that? Orangutan or orangutan?
Orangutan.
Oh, he had the correct pronunciation.
The word is of Malayan origin. In Malaya, orang means man, and utan means forest, meaning man of the forest.
Well, that's something I learned. Thank you. Well, you did pretty well at that, Dick. Now it's your turn to take it, Frank. Just wait a minute, Dick. Stay right there. Mr. Buck is going to ask you a question, so try and think up a tough one. All right, take it.
Well, he certainly had me hopping that time.
And while you're thinking about it, let's see. We'll remind all you contestants on this first of Frank Buck's Jungle Quizzes that each one of you will receive a copy of Frank Buck's new best-selling book, All in a Lifetime, especially autographed to each of you by the author, so make those questions tough. Frank, are you ready now?
Sure I am. Now, Jimmy, my boy.
The name is Dick.
Oh, Dick, I'm sorry, Dick. I got you mixed up with one of the other boys. You had a little fun with me. Now it's my turn. What do you call a litter of newly born dogs?
Puppies.
Well, but wait a minute. That isn't the whole question. The young of the dog family are called puppies. That's quite right. But I want to know something else. You can take either one of these two questions. Name me an animal in a dog family that does not have puppies. Or name me an animal that is not in the dog family that does have puppies. You understand that question? An Indian animal in the dog family that doesn't have puppies, if you're going to call something else besides puppies. Or name me an animal that's not in the dog family whose young is called puppies. Whose young are called puppies.
How about Dickie, Pinky?
Kangaroo.
No, a kangaroo doesn't belong to the dog family.
What's the correct answer, Mr. Buck?
Well, a seal is not a member of the dog family and it has pups.
That's the information. How about a hand for Dickie, boy?
Now, the other question.
All right.
He wins $5. A fox, which isn't the dog family, and has cubs instead of puppies.
A fox has cubs instead of puppies. All right, Dick, you won $5 for answering one of Mr. Buck's questions correctly. And now, let's dig into the old hat and see who's next on our question list. Well, it's Paul Pesky. Paul, where are you? Come on up. Let's give him a hand before he starts. He's written down two beauties for Frank. Let me assure you right now that no one except myself and the youngster who wrote out these two questions and Brother Law, who picked the questions out of the hat, has seen this list. I'm going to give it right back to Paul Wright now, and he and Frank are going to get together on their own. All right, Frank?
What is the name of a bear that does not drink water? The name of a bear that does not drink water. Well, now, Paulie, I think you've got me stuck there. There are many varieties of bears. There's a bear out in Malaya that drinks very little water. It's called the honey bear. It is entirely on honey. Polar bear drinks very little water because it swims so much in the water so much that it absorbs a lot of water through its skin. But as for a bear that never drinks water, I'm afraid you've got me stuck.
Where'd you get that question from, Paul?
Well, I saw it in the book already, and it's Koa. C-K-O-A.
Koala bear. That's a koala bear of Australia. It lives in the eucalyptus forest.
Good for you.
Eucalyptus forest in Australia. And it's a very rare variety of bear, and a very handsome bear. It's the model for the toy teddy bears we have in this country. We use as a model for making those bears. I believe that that's a mistake, because I think that I'm sure the koala bear does occasionally drink water. If it lives on eucalyptus leaves, and if they're kept as pets, as they are occasionally in Australia, they feed them pudding they make up and put a little bit of eucalyptus oil in the pudding so as to give them their sort of their natural food. But I'm sure they drink a little bit of water occasionally. However, if the book told you they don't drink water, perhaps they don't. Anyhow, you stuck me with a question.
You wouldn't call a koala bear Coco by...
No, hardly. The koala bear is a very interesting animal.
Your second question, Paul.
Is the zebra white with black stripes or black with white stripes?
Now there's a question. There's a fine question. There are several varieties of zebras. Now, the zebra called the Grevy zebra, which is the largest of all zebras, has an absolutely even number of stripes on its body. I mean, the white stripes are exactly the same size as the black stripes. And the stripes are all the way down to the hoof. As far as the Grevy zebra is concerned, there is absolutely no difference. He could be either a black animal with white stripes or a white animal with black stripes. But the zebra known as the Chapman zebra, that is the most plentiful of all zebras, has white on the belly and white from the knees down. So he has more white than he has black. For that reason, Encyclopedia will say that it's a white animal with black stripes. Now, on the other hand, the mountain zebra of South Africa has more black on it than it has white. But he's a very rare animal and seldom ever seen. So the encyclopedias tell you that the zebra is a white animal with black stripes.
A white animal with black stripes. That's a zebra. Why do they call him zebra over on the other side of the Atlantic?
That's merely the British way of pronouncing them, just as you pronounce a patent leather pair of shoes, they pronounce them patent leather pair of shoes.
All right, how about a hand for Paul on that one? And now, Mr. Buck, it's your turn. Why don't you ask Paul some questions?
Well, Paul, so far you seem to be winning a little bit of this argument. Now, let me see what we can do about that. There are three parts to this question. First, can you name me an animal, a mammal, that cannot walk? It used to be the basis of a great fishing industry. Yes, they fished for mammals.
Whale.
Whale. Correct. That's the right answer. Now, that's the easy part of the question. Now I want you to name them for me, a creature who can walk, but isn't a mammal.
A creature that can walk and isn't an animal? Mammal?
Now he can walk.
A seal?
What? No.
No.
A seal is a mammal.
It is a mammal.
How about giving him another crack at that, Mr. Buck?
Well, an animal that you had the animal that can't walk and is a mammal. Now you've got one that can walk and is not a mammal. And he has walks on four legs. There are three or four different animals of this description, very much alike.
What are the things they wrestle with down in Florida? Maybe that'll give you a hint.
Crocodile.
That's right.
Very good.
Crocodile, alligator, lizard, all that type of animal, or mammal, or not mammals, really. They're reptiles. Now, the third part of this question. Birds are supposed to fly. You can either name me one bird that cannot fly, or a creature that is neither bird nor insect, yet completely at home in the air.
Bat.
That's the second question. You're quite right. A bat or a flying fish. Both of them fly well and are not birds. Now, what about the bird that can't fly?
Penguin.
That's right.
Very good.
Penguin, ostrich, or emu, or cassowary.
Well,
right,
good
right,
for you, Paul.
Very clever.
You answered 3 questions, and you get $5 apiece for each question you answered. So you can take home with you $15. Good for you. And I suppose, before we take on the next of these beater downers, you tell us something about the question that another one of these lads has submitted. His name is Kisali, and the initial is J, so it sounds like Jimmy. Is that right, Jimmy? Joseph, come on up. And before we let you ask your question of Mr. Buck, I'd like to tell our listening audience that she's recovering from a tonsillectomy. All right, that explains everything. Here's your question, Joseph, and ask your question to Mr. Buck. Go ahead, first one.
Which is the rarest bird in Africa?
Which is the rarest bird in Africa?
Or in the world.
In the world? Well, that's sort of hard to answer because there are so many very, very rare birds. There are a lot of rare birds in Africa. There's the secretary bird, which has a plume on the back of its head and hangs down the back as if it had a quill behind its ear and stands on high, rather longish legs, which is a very rare bird, seldom ever seen outside of Africa. And there are several varieties of very rare hornbills, the turacos, what they call panton eaters, are all very rare. That's rather difficult to tell you, the rarest animal in Africa, or the rarest animal in the world. Now, down in New Guinea, they have birds of paradise, many, many varieties that have never been outside, never been brought out of New Guinea. And so there are rare birds all over the world. And what is your idea about the rare bird? When you asked me that question, when you made up that question, what did you have for an answer to it?
Well, I thought it was the boy got a unicarizaron on his...
You know, does your tonsils make your voice a little bit low? Will you speak a little louder now?
The boy that Juno carries around in a mint, I don't remember his name.
Oh, well, I wouldn't know that.
I'm sure there's usually eyes.
No, I don't know what that would be at all.
Which animal has the best sense of smell?
Which animal has the best sense of smell? Well, a lot of animals have a very keen sense of smell. The carnivorous animals... don't smell so very well. I tell you, the sense of smell of an animal depends on whether it has good eyesight or not. Now, you take a tiger or a leopard, they have wonderful eyesight. They can even see in the dark. So their sense of smell isn't so keen. They don't need that so much. But take a rhinoceros. He can only see clearly about 15 to 20 feet away. So his sense of smell is very, very keen. And his sense of smell is gauged largely by their ability to see well, whether they can see well or not. So there are many of them that have a very keen sense of smell, and you could hardly say which one has the best sense of smell, because there are plenty of them that have just as good a sense of smell as the other one. Which one do you have an idea has the best sense of smell?
I have no idea.
Well, I would think probably the rhinoceros has about as keen a sense of smell as any of them.
Will you ask your second question now, Joseph?
What's the second question?
That was the second.
Oh, that was the second. All right, then it's Mr. Buck's turn to ask you some questions. I believe he has some on that yellow sheet of paper at his right hand there.
Well, let's see what we have here. Can you give me the titles of 3 famous jungle pictures produced by Frank Buck?
Well, Frank Buck's Jungle Cavalcade.
That's the last one. That's the one that's playing now at the Palace Theater. Now, they have produced one that became famous all over the world. Made the greatest success of any wild animal picture ever made. Remember the name of that? That's the name that I use as sort of a slogan. A lot of people call me by that name.
B, you know, we introduced the program with that, Joseph.
What do people call me mostly?
Let's ask the audience. I think the boys know.
What is it, fellas?
Bring
him back alive, Frank Buck. That's bring him back alive. Now, can you name any other motion pictures that I produce, wild animal pictures? One called Wild Cargo. You remember another one, boys, any of you? Well, that's right. Wild Cargo, Fang and Claw, Bring Him Back Alive. And now, the current one is Jungle Cavalcade.
Well, that's fine, Joseph. You named one picture, so you get $5. Let's give Joseph a hand, boys. And now, Mr. Buck, there's a rather solemn, somewhat strange question submitted by Brother Law, who has these young wild animal tamers in his charge, and it's just this. Will a wild animal really die for its young?
Well, that isn't difficult to answer. Through thousands of years that there have been jungles, mothers have been giving their lives so that helpless youngsters might live a little longer. I've seen it happen with hen pheasants or quails right in this country. I've seen it many times in the mad, live-or-die life of the jungle. Come between a she-animal of any of the larger varieties and her young, and you're attempting suicide. But the story that sticks closest in my mind is the one about a monkey mother. She's just a common rhesus monkey. There are thousands of them all over India. I was down in southern India on one of my trips a good many years ago, and Ollie, my old number one boy, and I were going along a jungle trail. There's a little bit of clearing on one side, and suddenly we heard a rustle in the jungle and a sort of a plaintive cry, and a monkey came loping across the clearing just as fast as she could go, and behind her, a leopard. Going so fast, it's almost like a yellow streak was after her. Well, he lunged across the street after her and caught her just as she... across the trail. And he caught her just as she got over the trail. A little clearing. And as he caught her, just before he crouched down on her, I saw a little object sort of leave her. It looked as if she threw something. Well, this leopard went right off into the jungle. He carried this mother monkey away in his jaws. I went over and part of the grass kicked around, and I saw a little tiny baby monkey lying on the grass kicking and squawking. It wasn't more than about 3 or 4 inches long. It was probably not over 10 or 12 hours old. Now, it's the custom of the baby monkeys to hang on to their mother's breast. They put one little hand on in her hair on either side of the arms, and another little hand down on the two sides, and hold on to their fur. And she carries them all through the jungle like that, carries them everywhere. And she nurses them that way. And until they're pretty good size, able to get around on their own, they hang on to the mother. So anyhow, here was this leopard chasing the monkey mother. And he got so close that she knew that she was going to die. She knew he was going to get her. There wasn't any way in the world for her to get away. And when she could feel that hot breath of the leopard on her back, the last thing she thought of was to save her baby. And just as the leopard crouched down on her, she evidently tore the baby loose from her chest that he was hanging on and threw it as far as she could. Well, I went over and picked the little baby up, and my boy wrapped it up in a cloth he had and stuck it in the pocket of his jacket. And we took it on back to camp. And I got a hold of a medicine dropper, and we got some tin milk and canned milk, and fed it milk with a medicine dropper, and it grew up. Got along fine. Was a great pet around the camp for several months. But that was a great lesson to me of how these wild, primitive mothers take care of their young just as well as human mothers do. Here, the last thing that monkey thought of, the last thing that occurred to her was that she knew she was going to die, but she might be able to save her baby. And she threw it from her. And, of course, she did save it because I happened to be along to pick it up. If I hadn't, it would probably lay there and starve to death. But we took it back to camp and brought it up, and I had it for many, many months around with me.
Well, Frank, that's a grand story, and I think it answers definitely the question, will a wild animal really die for its young? Before we go on with the rest of our questions, would you happen to know where that little youngster you saved, that monkey, is today?
Why, he's in one of our big zoos. I think it's either New York or St. Louis. You see, I bring so many animals back that I sort of forget just where they are. But I remember after that trip, I sold quite a big colony of monkeys, both to the St. Louis Zoo and to the New York Zoo. And that little fellow was in the group. So he'd be in either one of those two. I could probably tell if I go back to my office and look at my records of where these shipments went. But I'm sure he's in one of the two zoos, and he's probably a fine, healthy, big monkey by this time.
Sure, just someone else that doesn't have to work for his living. All right, now, Mr. Big Game, bring him back alive. Here's your next opponent. He just took his questions out of the hat. George Priori. George, come on up. Let's give him a little hand to start things off. Very questions, George. Fire them away at...
All right, George, now what have you got?
What birds eat the food left over in the alligator's mouth?
What birds... Well, there's two different varieties of sparrows. They're sort of little sparrow-like birds that live in the jungle and run around where the crocodiles are and get into their mouth and pick when they eat food, they leave a lot of the little particles around their teeth, get in and pick them out of their mouth. Two different varieties of birds that do that. One is called a dial bird, D-Y-A-L, And the other one is, I don't just know what they call it, but it's got a native name, which is Buong. I don't believe there is any scientific name for it, because it's a bird very little known.
Well, what is a
pilot fish? A pilot fish is a fish that hangs on to a shark. Sharks in their wild state swim around the water, swim around the ocean, and one or two fishes with a sort of a sucker arrangement on top of their head come and attach themselves to the sharks and swim around with them.
That's right.
All right, Mr. Buck, now suppose you ask your question. Hit it out. Well, now, let's see. Asia, Africa, and Australia are three different continents. I'm going to give you five animals. I want you to name the one that can be found in each of these continents. And here they are. The gorilla. Where is the gorilla found?
No. Africa.
That's right. Found in Africa. Now, the giant panda.
This is a rule of continents.
The world? It's found on one of the continents. See, there's Asia, Africa, and Australia. It's found on one of those three continents. Panda, the great panda, the giant panda. You remember there's been a lot of publicity about them lately because we're the first ones ever brought to America came here very recently. One to the New York Zoo and one to the Chicago Zoo. And since that, there have been others brought here. But during the New York World's Fair, there was one out at the fair. They called it Pandora. It's a white and black bear-like animal. It's had a lot of publicity lately. There's been a lot of the papers about them. Very famous animal.
Except the Australian?
No, it comes from Asia. It comes from up in Yunnan. It comes from up on the border of North, Western China and Tibet.
Well, that's one you missed and one you got. How about one more, Mr. Buck?
Now, the dingo.
Australia.
That's right.
Australia, very good. All right, that's $10 you carry away with you there, George. And now, our next questions are going to be asked by Donald Blake. Donald, come on up here. Here's your chance to win $15. Take your questions and ask them of Mr. Buck. Sit right down there at the microphone. Go ahead.
How many apes have grown to maturity in the whole world?
How many apes have grown to maturity in the whole world? Oh, that couldn't possibly be answered because there are four varieties of apes. The apes are the gorillas, the chimpanzees, the orangutans, and the gibbons. And there have been, of course, well, through the thousands of years, there have been millions of apes born and grown to maturity in the jungle. So you couldn't possibly tell how many have reached maturity.
All right, how about asking your second question?
Now, your second one.
Is there a mammal that flies? If so, what is it?
Is there a mammal that flies? Yes, there's a bat is a mammal. We just had that question before.
Yes,
there are several varieties of flying lizards, and there are flying squirrels. There you are.
All right, now, Mr. Buck, your question is right there on the yellow sheet of paper. In two parts, you'll find them.
Where do elephants die?
The elephant's graveyard.
Well, elephants die wherever they happen to be. You know, there's a story about the elephants all going to one graveyard, going way up into the mountains and finding a secluded spot where they all die. That's just bunk. That's not true at all. Elephants die wherever they happen to be sick or where they happen to be where they happen to have to die. The reason that they had that story originally was because you seldom ever find a dead elephant in the jungle, unless it's been shot or something, or it's been killed. No more than you find a dead deer or a dead wolf in this country. Wild animals always go to a secluded spot to die. If a deer gets sick and goes away into the darkest ravine you can find, if a wolf gets sick and leaves the pack, or the pack chases it out, it won't have it in the pack, and it goes into a hollow tree or into a rock cave or somewhere to die. And the elephants are the same way. All animals go to a secluded spot to die. And where elephants die, of course, in tropical countries, the process of decomposition is very fast. And there are so many thousands of vultures and insects crawling that the body is devoured very soon, and even the bones decay and are done away with in a very little while. So The elephants' bodies are never found, except where they've been shot or killed or something. And that's how that story started about there being an elephant graveyard, but there really isn't any such a thing.
Well, that clears up a lot of misconceptions. Now, how about your second question, Mr.
Now, how do pythons kill their victims?
That's a snake, isn't it?
Now, python is the biggest variety of snake. It's the largest of all the snakes. How does he kill his victim?
Well, he crushes them,
for example. That's right. He crushes them. That's right. So the python is a constricting reptile. He constricts. Now, a python will get hungry. Now, they only eat about once every 6 weeks. And they'll crawl through the jungle, sometimes for miles, until they come to a game trail, and then they grab an animal by the throat or somewhere and twist their body around him, and inside of 2 or 3 minutes, got him squeezed to death.
Well, very good. Now, you can take $5 away with you, but don't be too sorry, because you can still show your locker key at the art theater and get in for 5 cents. Well, that about winds up this first session of our Frank Buck Jungle Quizzes, and we want to thank Brother Thomas Law and all the young fellas from the St. John's Orphanage in Brooklyn who came around and ask their questions of Mr. Frank Buck. I'll bring them back alive, and we hope they learned as much as we did, and we'd like you all to tune in again for our next session of Frank Buck's Jungle Quiz.
Well, I'm here for you, very smart, very intelligent, and you did a swell job.
Here's your morning news summary. War situation. Washington reports Soviet departments flee Moscow. Inside Tobruk, position where Blitz stood still described. Moscow claim annihilation of Nazis headed for Leningrad. Berlin, bombers blast road leading to Moscow from Smolensk. Berlin, potatoes put under strict rationing until new crop is in. Domestic. Bride 18 seized by husband 19. Dad asks for his arrest. Federal jury indicts 29 on charges of plotting armed revolt. Germany named as plotter in spy indictments against 39. Washington. President puts pressure on Congress to extend draft service. Senator Taft calls Iceland's seizure a deliberate step toward war. United States pouring materials into Egypt through Red Sea. Patterson says arms production is making great progress. Roosevelt asks power to order daylight saving for nation. Roosevelt forecasts far-flung legislation to control prices. Local Chicago. Independent National Survey shows 74.7% opposed to war. Courtney to take stand in Moriarty murder trial. Joker in new law nullifies city ordinance on liquor stores. Foreign news. Canada curbs gasoline sales, hence U.S. to follow suit. Sports. Zupke stays at Illinois. Wilson ousted. Yankees defeat White Sox 5-4. DiMaggio hits twice. Whirlaway scores easy victory over small field at Classic Trial. Reds shut out Braves 3-0 for third victory in series. Dodgers deal double defeat to Cubs 7-0 and 8-4. Commerce and Finance. Republic Steel to negotiate CIO union contract. Not a single strike troubles OPM, says Hillman. Chicago committee to consider grain storage problems tomorrow. Federal agency to spend $25 million on new arms plants. Cotton futures set 11-year peaks above 16 cents a pound. Charges stern roller tactics by Seaway Project backers. Stay tuned next for the Goldbergs.
And now, the Goldbergs. The character of a person's mind and heart can be rebuilt block by block and stone by stone if the architect knows where the faults are. And yesterday evening, as Sammy Goldberg walked home with Sylvia from the strangest picnic he'd ever been on, Sammy saw for the first time what Dr. Cater had been driving at, that Despite what Sylvia said, despite the things she did, her real desire was to find someone who could help and protect her. And this morning, as Molly gets breakfast and does a little ironing, she's thinking about Allison and his troubled daughter.
Rosalie, dear, just see that everything is on the table correctly. Papa shouldn't miss anything when he comes to sit down on the table for breakfast.
I know, Mom.
And hereafter, Rosalie, please don't do as heretofore.
What, Mom?
If anything needs special attention, let me know a little beforehand.
I can iron that, Mom.
That's not the question. Not the point. Not the question. If I'm ironing, I'm ironing. If you let me do something for myself once in a while, Ma, then...
Well, I'm here. Let me do. Turn out the light and the coffee dust. Let it percolate a little, just standing on the side.
Mm-hmm.
What's the matter, Sporty?
What's the matter, Sporty?
Leave Sporty outdoors, Rosie.
All right.
But close the door gently before the whole house wakes up.
Come on, Sporty.
True, it's what I have to do here before everybody gets up.
Sammy's up already.
Mm-hmm.
So early.
Mm-hmm.
How do you know?
I heard him.
Oh, what'll be with that boy? But do you think that the Dr. Kate is in love with Sylvia Moore?
Not my concern, Rosalie.
He's too good for her. Just like Sammy was too good for her.
Who'll be good enough for Sammy? Who?
I know exactly the kind of a girl I'd like to see.
A girl like you, Rosalie.
Mm-hmm. A girl like me, Mom. You'd like that, wouldn't you?
Very much. Where will Sammy find a girl like you?
He can't find somebody like me, then let him find somebody like you.
You see? You see now how you're going from the impossible to the extreme impossibility, huh?
What's the
laughing? Laughing, Jake. We're just...
There's so much to laugh about in my house, eh?
Here, Rosalie, take this rest.
Tell me the joke, let me also laugh.
Nothing, Jake.
Well, where ignorance is bliss, it's folly to be wise. Laugh, my dear daughter and dear wife, laugh.
Sit, Jake. Bring over a chair for Papa, dear, Rosalie. And put away the ironing board.
Where's my water?
Water? You're taking pills?
I just want water to drink without pills.
Oh. Without, water without pills, certainly. Jake, darling, what would you like to... Jake, dear?
What I can't have, evidently. Peace of mind.
I'll scramble you or maybe boil you better.
No eggs, thank you. You didn't cook cereal, huh?
Why didn't I?
Maybe it's the same as yesterday.
It isn't the same dish.
What kind?
The kind you like.
The way I feel,
Rosalie, I... Rosalie, dish Papa out.
Just two spoons.
Oh, Samuel?
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. You're up early, Samuel?
Why not?
Any reason why you're up so extremely A.M.?
No reason.
Just Samuel over
here, dear. I ask for cereal.
Rosalie, Papa asked for cereal.
I'm bringing it. Mr. Allison up yet?
Why, Sammy?
Here, Papa Jones.
You want to see Mr. Allison for something very special, Sammy?
Yes, very special.
Can you speak in complete sentences, Sammy? Not half sentences?
I want to speak to Mr. Allison, period.
All right, Sammy. I said it before, and I'm saying it now. Your life is in your own hands. Do with it as you will.
Jake, you're serious.
She told you she wouldn't marry you. Isn't that sufficient?
Jake.
Stop jaking me, Marla, please.
Bring Papa's coffee.
He's in love with Dr. Cater. Let him marry Dr. Cater.
Jake.
Yes, Jake. If you can see him throw his life away, I can.
Your coffee.
I can do without coffee. Oh.
Should I bother you? Give me the roller. That is not bothering. Pass me the roller, said Rosalie. Oh, my skin. And look, Papa's nervous. Slightly nervous. Push over, Rosalie. You must sit exactly there. Push over a little bit.
Yes.
Just family sugar. Eat the bread. Eat, family. Please. Allison?
Good morning.
Morning.
push over a chair for Miss Tallison? Miss Tallison, I'll fix you something.
Just some coffee, please.
Yes, Rosalie.
I didn't finish my breakfast yet.
I have something for you to do, dear. You'll bring in while I spill out.
How do you feel this morning, Sammy?
All right.
Sylvia up yet?
I don't think so. Mr. Allison?
Yes, Sammy?
I think you should go over to Dr. Cater and talk to him.
I'm afraid, Sammy, that I'm not a young girl. I can't confide so easily.
He doesn't want you to confide.
Whatever he wants, I don't understand. All I know is that confusion leads to confusion, with no way out.
It's because you don't want to find a way out.
Indeed I do, Sammy. But what can I do? Now she's in love with this Dr. Cater.
I don't think she is.
Your father says she is.
Sylvia says so, too. But I don't think she is.
That's too complicated for me.
Sylvia is complicated. And you're the cause of it.
Me?
Yes. After all this time, after blaming and arguing, suffering, too, you turn out to be the real cause of everything.
Is that what Dr. Cater says?
It's what I say.
That doesn't sound like you, Sammy.
The key to whatever is wrong with Sylvia is in you.
Are you becoming a psychoanalyst, too?
No.
That's a very easy way out, Sammy. Blaming me. Well, if that's what Sylvia thinks, I'm willing to take the blame. It won't be unusual. Children like to blame their parents.
The parents are most often to blame.
You speak as a child.
However I speak, the fact is that if you care at all for your daughter, you should go to Dr. Cater and...
And what can he tell me?
You mean, what can you tell him?
Me?
Yes, yes. Perhaps it's something you did once, Mr. Allison. Something you did or thought or caused. Something wrong that's made Sylvia what she is today.
Well, Sammy, what kind of talk is this?
I'm just telling you what I think. Think, Mr. Allison. Think back. What did you do? Think back. And don't tell me. Tell Dr. Cater. Yesterday, when Sylvia and I walked home from the picnic, funny picnic it was, too, she told me she was in love with Dr. Cater. And she said she wanted to love someone whom she would need. Someone who wouldn't need her. She wanted a protector, a rock to lean on. She wanted to be safe and hidden from the world. She thought Dr. Cater was the man. But that's only what she thinks. Sylvia wants a father, Mr. Allison. And in her mind, she has none. You don't seem to fit. But you're the only one that can fulfill the emptiness she lives with now. You're the one. And before you can do that, you have to confess, reveal, or discover what crime...
Crime?
I mean, what psychological crime perhaps you committed against Sylvia way back when she was a child.
I always was a good father, Sammy.
In your own mind. Remember, Mr. Allison, it's true. The sins of the parents are visited upon the children from generation to generation. Yes, Ma? Excuse me, Mr. Allison.
Hello, operator? Get me Dr. Cater's office, please. Yes. Dr. Cater, Jr.
And Allison thinks back and sitting quietly, suddenly sober, not fighting back. What did happen so many years ago, and how will it affect Sammy's life and Sylvia's?
Stay tuned next for The Adventures of Superman.
Presenting the transcription feature, Superman!
Bird, it's a plane.
It's Superman. Yes, it's Superman, strange visitor from the planet Krypton, who came to Earth with powers and abilities far beyond those of mortal men. Superman, who can leap tall buildings at a single bound, race a speeding bullet to its target, bend steel in his bare hands, and who, disguised as Clark Kent, mild-mannered reporter for a great metropolitan newspaper, fights a never-ending battle for truth and justice.
And now to our story. Looking forward to their 2-week dog sled trip through the North Woods and up into Canada, Clark Kent and young Jimmy Olsen ran into trouble their first night out. No sooner had Batiste, their French-Canadian guide, selected a campsite and built a fire Then two hard-bitten men armed with rifles came out of the woods, said they were game wardens, and ordered our friends to move on. But Kent, suspicious, chose to disobey the order. With the fire out, he sat in the darkness while Jimmy and Batiste slept. Suddenly, a mysterious plane appeared overhead, dropped something in the woods, and roared off. Jimmy, awakened by the drone of the motor, sat up with Kent. Shortly after, they heard voices coming from the dense woods. The two alleged game wardens were looking for whatever the plane had dropped.
Keep low, Jimmy. Flat on the ground.
You seem to be coming closer, Mr. Kent.
Yeah, forget it. Six freshies know by now how to drop them shipments somewhere near the shack.
It ain't over this far, boys.
Sounds like those two game wardens. That's who it is.
Shh. All right, come on this way.
They're going back.
Oh. What's the matter?
Turn away. Gosh, Mr. Kent, the sled dogs.
Shut! Hear them, dogs! They're close by!
Jimmy, get to those dogs as fast as you can and see if you can quiet them. Hurry!
Okay, I'll try.
Come up over near the clearing, Bull. Must be them campers.
Oh, yeah. Your shotgun loaded?
Yeah.
Okay, follow me. I'll teach them a lesson they won't forget in a hurry. Maybe you better teach them the lesson first.
Where is he? Shine the light.
Oh, no, you don't. That takes care of the flashlight. Now, drop that shotgun.
I have it! Stop!
That won't do you any good.
I have it!
That's the last time that gun will ever shoot.
Look out, Bull. He's got the gun.
Yes, and I'm going to twist it into a pretzel.
Look what he's doing to the gun! Come on, you crazy fool! Run!
I'd like to go after them, but I can't take a chance. Not with Jimmy and Batiste around.
Kent, where are you? What happened? I healed the shot.
See, it's back to Clark Kent for me, and fast. Here I am, Jimmy!
Oh, gosh. I heard that shot, and I thought you'd been hit. Where are those two men?
Hey, what is happening here? Who fired the shot? Who tried to kill Batiste?
Nobody tried to kill anyone, Batiste.
Well, I healed the shot. Ooh.
That's right. One of our game warden friends fired at me.
Too many crickets, Mr. Kent.
Well, what is it, Jimmy?
Look at the shotgun I found in the snow. It's a barrel. Twisted like a pretzel.
Sacré bleu, it is Grizzly Bear do this.
It's what?
Grizzly Bear. Where is my Grizzly Bear?
Has he gone mad?
He's trying to say that a big grizzly bear twisted the barrel of the shotgun.
Oh, that's nonsense.
Oh, then who did twist it? People don't shoot guns like this.
Well, here comes Batiste, loaded for bear.
Show me where bear go, I chase him.
I tell you, there wasn't any bear, Batiste.
Oh, oui, it must be. Look at the shotgun. Only grizzly bear to these two barrels. Batiste, remember, 4 years ago, there was big blizzard.
Yes, yes, we know, Batiste. 75 grizzly bears attacked you.
Oh, no, monsieur. Only 6.
Yeah, well, all right, you'll tell us about that some other time. Right now, we're going to light a fire.
Oh, but what about the game wardens, Mr. Kent?
I don't think they'll bother us tonight. All right, put your gun away, Batiste.
Monsieur, these I do not like.
Whether you like it or not, put the gun away. There aren't any bears. All right, come on, Jimmy. Let's get a fire started.
Oh, you still haven't explained how this shotgun happened to get all twisted up, Mr. King.
Jimmy, there are some things that can't be explained. Chalk this up as one of them. Now, let's get that fire going.
Unable to tell Jimmy how the shotgun barrel was tied into a knot, Kent squeezes out of the embarrassing situation as best he can. Meanwhile, the two men who were frightened off by Superman reached their shack in the woods.
Bolt the door, Chuck.
Yeah.
Get my rifle. Keep watch at the window.
Yeah, okay.
They won't find us so easy, Bolt. That trail's no cinch to follow at night.
I told you I wasn't taking no chances before. I ain't taking no chances now. Yeah. I never thought we'd get through them woods without a light.
Yeah, me with a twisted ankle.
Keep watching that window. If you see anyone, shoot to kill.
Well, I don't like this business.
Who cares whether you like it or not? Want to get tossed in the clink?
No, but I don't like shooting.
You better start learning to like it right now. We're good for 5 years if they nab us.
Yeah. Maybe we'd be better off scrambling.
And leave $5,000 worth of stuff sitting in the woods. Not on your life. Are you watching that window?
Yeah, I'm watching. Bull.
What?
That guy that grabbed the shotgun. He was pretty big.
I told you he was big the first time I seen him.
He looked bigger this time.
What happened when I said to you to give it to him? How come you missed?
I don't know. That's what I don't understand. I was right on top of him.
You got an eye like an eagle. Next time, I'll handle the gun.
That suits me.
I figured it would. Some guys are born chicken-hearted.
I ain't chicken-hearted. Just because I don't like shooting.
Shut up. Watch that window.
You got no right to blame me. Why don't you blame Frenchie? He's the guy that didn't drop the shipment right.
I'll take care of him later. Right now, we got to worry about that government guy.
Yeah? Well, you know he's government.
I know. I can smell him out.
Well, then what's he got that kid along for?
Just to make it look like he ain't government.
Hey, Bo. Well, they're lighting a fire.
Yeah?
I can see it from here. See it?
Yeah. Okay. Let them light it. That means they ain't looking for us. That means we got time to figure something out.
Oh. Then I don't have to watch no longer?
No. But keep the rifle handy.
Okay. I'll set it right here by the window. Hey, Bull. Well, how do you think they got onto us?
Yeah, I don't know. What difference does it make?
Guess we gotta move, huh?
Maybe not.
What do you mean?
Ever step into a bear trap, Chuck?
No, I don't want to.
Them traps can hold a 600-pound bear.
Yeah? What's that got to do with it?
Up in Newfoundland once, a trapper stepped into one of them by accident. He didn't look so good when they found him. He didn't look good at all.
What are you driving at, Bill?
We got three traps here. Big ones.
Yeah. So what?
That government guy will be looking for us in the morning.
Yeah?
Chances are he'll pick up that trail through the woods. He can find it in daylight.
Now, wait a minute, Bull. You ain't thinking of setting them traps.
That's exactly what I'm thinking. Set all three of them on the trail, so in case he misses one, we still got two chances to get him.
No, you can't do that, Bull. Them traps will take a man's leg off.
I know it.
I don't want no part of it. I tell you, I don't want
to... Shut up. You got plenty of time for crying after they nab us. But they ain't nabbed us yet, so don't pull no act on me.
I ain't pulling no act. I just come in on this because you said there wouldn't be no rough stuff.
I'll handle all the rough stuff. All you got to do is stand by. Now get them traps up. They're in that closet. And they need some oiling.
Well, we got to do it this way.
You know any better way? Come on, get the traps.
These them here?
Yeah, all of them out. That's it. Dump them on the floor. Yeah. They look like they're in pretty good shape. This one could stand a little oil. Hand me that can on the shelf.
Yeah. Here.
They use traps like this to get them big Alaska brown bears. Nothing gets loose from them.
I don't like this, Bull.
Too many things you don't like. How about the payoff? You like that?
I ain't saying anything about the payoff.
Oh, I see. The dough's all right. You like that. Only working for it don't suit you. What's the matter? You got a weak stomach? Okay, they're all ready now. Get a shovel.
Where are we going?
To set them out. Where'd you think?
Maybe you better count me out of this, Bull.
What are you talking about?
Yeah, I mean it. I don't want my cut in this shipment. Just count me out. I'll beat it.
That's what you think. Now listen to me. You're in. And you're in solid.
Yeah, but I'm willing to pass up my...
And I'm not willing to let you. Grab those traps and the shovel. I'll carry the gun this time. Come on. Come on, I said.
Okay. I'm coming.
Okay, we'll set the last one here. Start digging. Not so deep.
Keep it quiet. You want them to hear us? Say, you're trying to tip them off.
No, I ain't trying nothing, Bull.
I got a good mind to conk you with the butt of this rifle. Go ahead and dig. Okay, that's enough. I'll set the trap in the hole.
Take it easy.
All right.
Yeah.
Cover it with snow. That does it. Now, wait a minute. Part of it's showing. Cover it up. That's enough. Now let's see how far that big guy gets without stepping into one of these. Come on, back to the shack. And stay off the trail. Unless you want to lose a leg.
Well, the outlook isn't too bright for Kent and Jimmy in case they decide to do some exploring once daylight comes. If they do pick up the forest trail, as Bull expects them to, the hidden bear traps loom dangerously along the path. What will happen?
Don't forget, tune in again for the next thrilling episode with Superman!
Look! Up in the sky!
It's a bird!
It's a plane!
It's Superman! Superman is a copyrighted feature appearing in Action Comics magazine.
Stay tuned next for some big band music.
And good evening and greetings, everybody. Once again, it is a pleasure and the privilege of the National Broadcasting Company to bring you the music of Jimmy Dorsey, world-celebrated saxophonist and clarinetist, with his famous orchestra playing for you once again in the beautiful Café Rouge of Hotel Pennsylvania in New York City. And now Jimmy and all the boys give their best in a little bit of popular rhythm titled Turn Left. Jimmy Dorsey, ladies and gentlemen, world-celebrated saxophonist with his famous dance orchestra at Hotel Pennsylvania in New York City. Contrast in music by Jimmy and all the boys. Contrast brings us now to a very beautiful melody, one of Jimmy's greatest selling records of the day. Beautiful song sung for you in contrast by Bob Eberly and Helen O'Connell, and the title is Amapola.
A maid with a way of whispering, si, senor. Each night, while guitars would softly play, the tune seemed to dance round the words that he'd say. Amapola, my pretty little poppy, you're like that lovely flower, so sweet and heavenly. Since I found you, my heart is wrapped around you, and loving you it seems to be a rhapsody. Amapola, the pretty little poppy, must copy its endearing charm from you. Amapola, Amapola, how I long to hear you say, I love you.
Found you, my heart is wrapped around you, and loving you it seems to be a rhapsody. Amapola, the pretty little poppy, must copy its endearing charms from you. Amapola, Amapola,
medium tempo, Bob Everly returns once again to sing us a very beautiful thing called Blue Champagne.
with the echoes that still remain. I keep a blue rendezvous. Bubbles rise like a fountain before my eyes, and they suddenly crystallize to form a vision of you. All the plans we started, all the songs we sang, each little dream we knew seems to overtake me like a boomerang. Gone is the sparkle, blue is the tang. Each old refrain keeps returning as I remain with my memories and blue champagne to toast the dream that was you. Well, folks, during these past 2 years, and even better, it has been my honor to have the happy privilege of being assigned to do the major portion of Jimmy Dorsey's radio broadcasts over these NBC networks. During that time, you've heard me say, probably on many occasions, that Jimmy was undoubtedly the world's greatest saxophonist and clarinetist. And also during that time, you've heard him play scores and scores of numbers. Well, there seems to have been a little question as to whether Jimmy really was the best saxophonist and the best clarinetist. Well, for my part, I always thought that he was. And some of the boys in the band says, well, let's make him prove it. So, virtuoso as Jimmy is, the boys wrote a number, and here it comes, one of the grandest things you ever heard Jimmy do. It's called Finger Busters.
Thank you.
guess I'm vindicated, all right. Or am I? I certainly am. Jimmy, if you have enough wind and energy after that rendition, come over here to the microphone. I want to talk to you for a minute.
Righto, Bill.
What I want to say is just this, Jim. Here we stand on the bandstand in the Café Rouge of Hotel Pennsylvania tonight. NBC is bringing to its American audience coast to coast, border to border, your music, which is practically unparalleled.
Thank you, Bill. People
throughout the entire United States say so, and we feel it just as much as they do. Right at the moment, you're just about the busiest fellow that New York has ever seen. You're working at the Pennsylvania Hotel. You're doing the first week of a 4 or 5 or 6 week engagement in one of New York's biggest theaters. You're doing
Strand.
A commercial program, the Strand Theater. Well, you did it.
Plugola there.
Well,
know,
that's perfectly
not?
All right. Fine. The show is pretty good, too, I understand.
Terrific, Bill.
I haven't had an opportunity to get over there yet, but I will before you leave. Rest assured. No, you're working here at the Pennsylvania. You're at the Strand Theater. You're doing your broadcast right at the moment, and you're also doing a commercial program. Tell me, how do you boys, along with radio's lovely lady, Helen McConnell, survive this severe test of singing?
Always drinking an awful lot of beef broth.
Oh, I see. Well, all kidding aside, Jim, I want you to know that the National Broadcasting Company is always on hand whenever you are around to be had with your music, and it's a distinct pleasure for us to give it to our NBC audience coast to coast.
Now, thank you, Bill, and I assure you it's my pleasure. It's our pleasure.
Isn't your closing night here at the Café Rouge, but due to pressing engagements, you can't get on the air with us on this dance program until after you've gone, so this must be your so long until next time to our
Pennsylvania
dance audience, right?
That's right. Well, we'll be back.
Oh, of course you'll be back, that we know. Let's carry on our music now, and let's see what we do next year. Bob Eberle, that favorite baritone of all America, singing My Sister and I. The warm and lovely world we knew has been struck by a bitter frost. But my sister and I recall with a sigh the world we knew and loved and lost. My sister and I remember still a tulip garden by an old Dutch mill, and the home that was all our own until. But we don't talk about that. My sister and I recall once more the fishing schooners pulling into shore, and the dog cart we drove in days before. But we don't talk about that. We're learning to forget the fear that came from a troubled sky. We're almost happy over here, but sometimes we wake at night and cry. My sister and I recall the day we said goodbye and then we sailed away, and we think of our friends who had to stay, but we don't talk about that. Learning to forget the fear that came from a troubled sky. We're almost happy over here, but sometimes we wake at night and cry.
My sister and I recall the day we said goodbye and then we sailed away. And we think of our friends who had to stay. But we don't talk about that. And now here is radio's lovely lady, beautiful Helen McConnell, with a little rhythmic thing called Man That's Groovy. A little few notes of those sowing wild notes, eh? Which brings us to the end, ladies and gentlemen, of our program tonight. Time to say so long to the music of Jimmy Dorsey. Playing for you in the beautiful Cafe Rouge of Hotel Pennsylvania in New York City. This is the Blue Network of the National Broadcasting Company.
Some great music right there over NBC. Just some great... Man, I would have loved to have lived back then and been able to tune into some live big band music back after 10 o'clock at night as you're laying in bed getting ready to go to sleep. The soft glow of the dial just shining on you as you're drifting off to sleep. Just some great stuff. My name is Henry Chop, your host, and that's the way it was on July 15th and July 16th, 1941. In just a little bit, I will tell you what we are going to listen to tomorrow night. If you enjoy the content of this channel, not only subscribe, but please donate to its upkeep. Because of the vintage radio, music, and films that we share, this channel does not qualify for YouTube monetization. help motivate us to consistently post this wonderful content. We like to think that this channel is more interesting and entertaining than any other World War II channel on YouTube. Help us keep going by donating. In the expanded description section to this video, you will find two links for which to donate. One is for PayPal and the other is for a GoFundMe. If the GoFundMe link is outdated on this video, go to this channel's description or our latest video where you will find an updated link. Any little bit helps. If you love old-time radio, film, and music, don't forget to subscribe to this channel and click on the bell icon to get notifications as to when a new upload will premiere. If you are interested in World War II as much as I am, check out our other channel, the World War II Newspaper Channel. Expand the description section to this video and you will see a link that will take you there. Now I'd suggest listening to the latest upload to decide if it's your thing. Over there you will hear the Chicago Tribune read to you for between 90 minutes to 2 hours. You will get a much more detailed look about what it was like to actually live through World War II than I can give you just by sharing radio broadcasts. You will not only hear detailed news of the big battles and historical events, you will hear trivial facts about the war. You will hear news from the United States home front from the early stages of U.S. mobilization and war protests to Pearl Harbor and the ramping up of the war machine to the final victories and reconversion. You will hear every facet of American life change forever. If you are following us through the 1941 playlist, the next programs that will be up tomorrow, we will have the Goldbergs, Vic and Sade, Speaking of Liberty, Famous Fathers, a new movie serial, Holt of the Secret Service, Chapter 1 in that movie serial. Then following that, we will have The Adventures of Superman, The Lone Ranger, and the game show Double or Nothing, the quiz show. That is one of my favorite old-time radio quiz shows, actually, so it's going to be fun to listen to that. And if you are following us via the premiere, we will be flashing back to 1938 tomorrow, January 20th and the 21st, it looks like. That's what we're going to be doing. We're going to have two episodes of Jerry of the Circus. We are going to have The Witch's Tale. Two episodes of Honor the Law. We are going to have a movie serial, Chapter 1 of Dick Tracy. I haven't started a movie serial in 1938 yet, so we are going to start that. We will have The Lone Ranger. We will have an address by H.W. Van Loon. And, that's the way we'll close it out, I guess. Either way, you're going to enjoy tomorrow night. Let's turn off this old tube radio. That's our time machine. Good night. God bless.
This changing world, this changing scene, where is it taking us? What does it mean? As long as we're certain of each other, we know we don't have to be afraid. These changing times we rise above. We have no time for them. We have our love, and love is the only thing that still remains the same through all this change.